The Polish-Swedish Wars were a series of wars between the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and Sweden. Broadly construed, the term refers to a series of wars between 1563 and 1721. More narrowly, it refers to particular wars between 1600 and 1629. These are the wars included under the broader use of the term. The 16th century conflict, sometimes referred to as the Livonian War, the war against Sigismund, in 1598, the War of 1600-29, which was twice interrupted by periods of truce and can be divided into the War of 1600-11, the War of 1617-18, the War of 1621-25, the War of 1626-29. The conflicts in the second half of the 17th century known as the Deluge, the Great Northern War, the War of the Fourth Coalition, in which Poland, by then partitioned, was represented by the Polish legions in Napoleonic service. The last Polish-Swedish War was the War of the Sixth Coalition, because the Duchy of Warsaw was a Napoleonic ally, whereas the Kingdom of Sweden was a member of the anti-Napoleonic coalition. Livonian War, War against Sigismund. The conflict between Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and Sweden can trace its roots to the war against Sigismund, where Sigismund III Vasa, at one time king of both the Commonwealth and Sweden, lost the throne of Sweden during the Civil War. Few Commonwealth troops participated in this conflict, and it is mostly regarded as a Swedish civil war, not part of the Polish-Swedish Wars. After early stalemate, Sigismund was defeated in the Battle of Stangebro in 1598, and by 1599, Sigismund was dethroned by his uncle, Duke Charles, and forced to retreat to the Commonwealth. This also spelled the end of the short-lived personal union between Poland and Sweden. Polish-Swedish War of 1600-11. However, even after being dethroned, Sigismund did not give up on regaining the Swedish throne, and from then on, most of his policies would revolve around his attempts to conquer Sweden. Even though Commonwealth nobility had little will for such a long and bloody conflict, Sigismund started his plan in 1599, when he confirmed the Pacta Conventa, documents with promises he signed when elected as a king of Poland, which stated that the then Swedish territory of Estonia would now become part of the Commonwealth. Polish nobility, the Szlachta, supported this particular conflict, assuming it would be limited to Estonia only, and expecting many gains in form of new lands and increases of grain export through access to Estonian ports on the Baltic Sea. In addition, Szlachta did not think highly of the Swedes, and did not expect this war to drag long or be difficult. They grossly underestimated their opponent, thinking that Poland, having been nearly undefeated in battle for over 100 years, would be easily able to parry any attacks of the Scandinavians. The Commonwealth had nearly 10 million inhabitants, almost 10 times that of 1 million in Sweden. On the other hand, Szlachta forgot that the Commonwealth had one of the smallest military-to-population ratios in Europe, and could not know that Swedish army was highly trained and motivated. Sweden was able to draft a large army much more quickly than the Commonwealth, due to its centralized government and obligatory draft of free peasants. The Commonwealth was forced to fight on two fronts, as its armies were also needed south to deal with the Moldavian Magnate Wars, and Swedish forces quickly gained 3-to-1 numerical superiority. In the beginning of the war, in 1600, although a Commonwealth army under command of Great Lithuanian Hetman Christoph Mykolai, the Thunderbolt Radziwill striking first, was able to deal the Swedish forces several defeats in the open fields. Swedes took control not only of Estonia, but of most of Livonia, the Commonwealth territory south of Estonia. The Polish-Lithuanian parliament, the same, reacted by increasing funds for the army and recalling forces and commanders from the southern front to the threatened north. In 1601, Polish Hetman Jan Karol Chodkiewicz and Polish Chancellor Jan Zamoyski, recalled from Moldavia, arrived in Lithuania to fight the Swedish incursion, which now threatened not only the Estonia promised by Sigismund, but older Polish territories south of it. Chodkiewicz and Radziwill defeated the Swedes in the first major open battle of this war at Kokenhusen in early 1601. Soon afterwards, Jan Zamoyski, fresh from his victory against the Moldavians, came in to help against the Swedes, with 12,000 men and 50 artillery pieces, 15 of which were classified as heavy. Charles was unable to deal effectively with such an army and was forced to retreat. However, during the retreat he left sizable numbers of defenders of various captured fortresses in Livonia. Zamoyski now took to siege warfare instead of chasing the retreating king, soon capturing Wolmar and Falin. By 1602, the Swedes were only left with control of Reval, Panor, Hapsal and Orpate. However, Zamoyski, now 60 years old, had fallen ill and Chodkiewicz took command and laid siege to Dorpate. At Wessenberg, he defeated a Swedish reinforcement force sent in to help Dorpate, which was soon forced to surrender. Chodkiewicz was appointed acting commander-in-chief of Lithuania forces after Zamoyski's return south in 1602. Chodkiewicz, despite inadequate supplies and little support from the Commonwealth Sejm and King Sigismund III Vasa, brilliantly distinguished himself, capturing fortress after fortress and repulsing the Duke of Södermanland, afterwards Charles IX, from Riga. However, Reval, Panor, and Nowa remained under Swedish control. In 1604 he captured Dorpate, twice defeated the Swedish generals at Biela Kamien and near Weissenstein. For his valor Chodkiewicz was rewarded by the king with the Grand Hetman Bulawar of Lithuania. However, the war was neglected by the Commonwealth's parliament, which turned a deaf ear to all his requests for reinforcements and for supplies and money to pay his soldiers. Commonwealth decentralized financial system meant that the Commonwealth treasury was almost always empty. This flaw plagued Commonwealth for centuries. Chodkiewicz nevertheless more than held his own against the Swedes. He instituted a new form of warfare based upon his use of the elite Hussar cavalry and consequently the Swedes were repeatedly defeated again and again in the open field. First the Commonwealth forces attacked Swedish cavalry, after which they usually attacked demoralized Swedish infantry which was unable to retreat at all, and usually annihilated whole formations of this infantry. In 1605 the Swedes again spent large sums of money to conscript a new massive army. Riksdag spent much cash on conscripting new formations and as well as this, Russian Tsar Boris Godunov gave the Swedes much financial help, likely attempting to keep both Sweden and the Commonwealth busy during the time of troubles. The Swedes were able to hire large numbers of mercenaries, as well as hiring many siege engineers from all over Europe. In 1605, a few miles from Reval, a 5,000-strong army led by Anders Lennartsson landed in Estonia again. Several days later another Swedish expedition, numbering around 4,000 and led by Count Frederick Joachim Mansfeld, landed near and besieged the fortress of Dunamunda near Riga, although without any success. After this setback they now began laying siege to Riga. Their main mission was to capture this important city, one of the largest Baltic ports. Chodkiewicz moved in to relieve the garrison at Riga, but found out that the Swedes were also sending in reinforcements under Lennartsson. Chodkiewicz moved in on Lennartsson, however he decided not to allow for open battle and retreated into a fortress. On finding out that Charles himself was now marching in with yet more reinforcements, Lennartsson decided to link up with the king and assault Riga together. Chodkiewicz, who failed to prevent the Swedish forces from joining, moved from Ces to near Kirkemaniskil, where he built his small fortified camp. Charles, who has arrived at Riga on the 23rd of September, learned of the Chodkiewicz force nearby and decided to destroy it with an attack of majority of Swedish force within the area. On the 27th of September, Swedish force under King Charles moved towards Kirkham. The Battle of Kirkham on September 27, 1605, near Duna River would be Chodkiewicz's crowning achievement. Chodkiewicz, having smaller forces, used a feint to force the Swedes off their high position. The Swedes under Charles thought that the Lithuanians with small support of Poles were retreating, therefore, they advanced, spreading out their formations to give chase. This is what Chodkiewicz was waiting for. The Commonwealth's army now gave fire with their infantry, causing the Swedes some losses, at which point the Hussars moved into a reformation and charged at the Swedish infantry formations. The Swedish formations broke completely, the king himself fleeing, barely escaping back to his flotilla off the coast. Thus Chodkiewicz, with barely 3,600 troops, defeated an 11,000-man Swedish army, inflicting 5,509,000 casualties, for which feat he received letters of congratulation from the Pope, all the Catholic potentates of Europe, and even from the Sultan of Turkey and the Shah of Persia. Yet this great victory was absolutely fruitless, owing to the domestic dissensions which prevailed in the Commonwealth during the following 5 years. Chodkiewicz's own army, unpaid for years, abandoned him at last en masse in order to plunder the estates of their political opponents, leaving the hetman to carry on the war as best he could with a handful of mercenaries paid out of the pockets of himself and his friends. With tiny, inadequate forces, Chodkiewicz nonetheless prevented Swedes from overrunning the entire Inflanty region, helped by a relative inaction of Swedish commanders until 1608. Chodkiewicz, who was one of the magnates who remained loyal to the king, had to divide his attention between the rebellion against Sigismund in the Commonwealth and fresh invasion of Livonia by the Swedes led by Mansfeld in 1608. Mansfeld captured Dunamunda, Falin, and Kokenhusen, but when Chodkiewicz returned, the tide turned. In 1609, Chodkiewicz once more he relieved Riga besides capturing Panor. Chodkiewicz also defeated the Swedish flotilla at Salis and finally defeated Mansfeld's army once again near the river Goja. Eventually, a truce was signed in 1611 after the death of Charles IX. It would last until 1617. During the next decade, Commonwealth was occupied by its aggression against Russia. Southern borders were also endangered by the constant troubles with Ottoman Empire magnate wars in Moldavia. Polish-Swedish War of 1620-25. Having signed the Treaty of Stolbovo ending their Ingrian War with Russia in 1617, the Swedes, led by King Gustav II Adolf, who was hailed as savior of Protestant Europe, turned their attention to the Commonwealth again. They have expanded their gains in the disputed Livonia region, taking Dunamunda and Panor in 1617. When the truce expired in November 1620, Gustav Adolf succeeded in taking the city of Riga after a few weeks of siege. Commonwealth, occupied by a serious war with Ottomans, was unable to send significant forces to stop Gustav Adolf, and was forced to sign a truce favorable to Gustav Adolf. Commonwealth was forced to cede Livonia north of Dvina River, and retained only a nominal control over Riga. A new truce in Mitar was signed and lasted from November 1622 to March 1625.